You know, some people look at trauma and they say Aboriginal people in Canada and around the world were at risk, we're vulnerable, and we're marginalized, and you marshal the therapists to come and see us. But what I see is injustice. And it's so easy, the children would say, that even an adult can get it. Trauma and multi-generational trauma doesn't happen because we're somehow linked in a bad spot. It happens because in your country and in mine, the greatest persecutors of human rights abuses have always been our own governments. And it's been made possible because of our silence and our complacency and our normalization of discrimination. And these children know that the only way to stop that is to speak out. You know, an elder once told me, he said, you need four things to change the world. He said, knowledge, and a lot of people have that. You need persistence, and some people have that. You need passion, and a lot of people will criticize you for that. We're really good at that in social work, aren't we? He or she is too political, too passionate. And you need spirit, and you need to remember that. Need spirit, and you need to remember that. The journey of our two countries is very similar. This is a warrant from 1895. It is Duncan Campbell Scott. Some of you know him as a poet from Canada. He was also the superintendent of Indian Affairs. And that warrant was for the removal of First Nations children and their placement in residential schools. Schools is not really the proper word for them because they weren't meant to educate. They were meant to assimilate. And Canadian children would be forcefully removed between the ages of 5 to about 15 and placed in these schools where they would have all of their belongings taken from them. They would be required to speak English or French, and if you spoke your Indigenous language, you would be beaten. Many children died there. We know that 6,000 children died from abuse, neglect, starvation, and servitude and preventable disease. And the Truth and Reconciliation Commission believes it actually was closer to 60,000. And these children were removed from their families under this warrant because they were not properly cared for at home. And they were placed in the residential schools. Now, there are very few in our country today that would tell you now that the residential schools actually were an improvement over those home conditions. And yet, in child welfare, and I did child welfare for 13 years, in child welfare, I would do a risk assessment on the family, but I would never do a risk assessment on the system and what we had to offer. And on one of my previous trips here, I'll never forget an Aboriginal woman who was in child welfare care. She said, you know, the one thing that child welfare needs to know is that moment when you remove me, you promise me the possibility, at least, of a better life. And when they removed me, they did not deliver. They did not deliver. So we're part of this long history. It's not as if residential schools stopped and they were perpetrated by a bunch of people who didn't know better. In fact, we had, even in those times, caring First Nations and non-Aboriginal people pressing back against the system. But the forward movement of this idea, of this program of removing Aboriginal children and helping them progress to this other place, has been embedded in child welfare systems in countries throughout the world. It is what you were talking about, Michael. It is the system working properly. But the problem is the system is becoming even more efficient in our country than it was then. And it's fueled by this inequality. This is our Auditor General. We are one of the wealthiest nations in the world, and as the Auditor General has repeatedly said, First Nations communities receive far less funding for education, health care, child welfare care, and all others, even though we have higher needs because of the horrors of residential schools. And how is this gone on for so long in a wealthy country like ours? Well, it's gone on because the Canadian government spins a lot of stereotypes that I find very interesting. Now, the first one is that we as First Nations cannot manage our money. Now, it is one of the things where it is very pervasive. In fact, we had a couple of incidents where there was some financial mismanagement in the First Nations, and the government moved quickly to create a First Nations accountability law. How many here have heard of Rob Ford, our mayor from Toronto? He's notorious. We had three mayors arrested in Quebec in 1 year. The Parliament didn't move to do a Mayor of Montreal Accountability Act or a Rob Ford Accountability Act. There's another one. First Nations are too remote. Well, I find that really interesting. I don't know if it's true in your country as it is in mine, but the only time the politicians talk about remoteness is when they're talking about people. When they're talking about diamonds, oil, or minerals, they will be up there with their parkas in minus 50 degree weather eating seal meat in no time. We had a Canadian astronaut twittering from space into Parliament, and no one said he was too remote. And then we get this whole idea of complexity, and I guess that's where I have a bit of a different take than some people. I think complexity is often just an excuse to do nothing. And we get this a lot. One in six of our First Nations communities, the children in those communities, do not have clean drinking water or no water at all. And the reason the government gives is, well, it's too complex. But we send DART teams, that's our emergency response team, halfway around the world, and we can have water pumping in an earthquake zone in 24 hours, including the flight. It's not about complexity. It's about racism. And it's about discrimination. And we have to unpack those things because it's those narratives in our heads that stop us from looking at where the real problem is. And sometimes this discourse around trauma can do the same thing. We can be looking over here at the Aboriginal people and the trauma that they're experiencing, which is real and needs to be responded to. But the government is much more happy to invest over here because they don't want you looking over here. They don't want you looking over here. Now, why is this equality thing interesting? We've heard from some of our other presenters about it. This is one of my favorite books. If I became Prime Minister of Canada, and I toy with the idea every once in a while, but I know I would only survive in power for maybe a day or so before they kick me out. But I would get rid of all of the government ministries. And I would create only one department, and that department's mandate would be to reduce the inequalities in our own country. Because the very best data around the world says if you want to increase lifespans, increase education, have a robust economy, reduce diabetes rates, have less people incarcerated, more trust in communities, you need to only do one thing, and that's reduce that gap. That's the best mental health intervention you can make. And you can read the book, The Spirit Level, yourself and go on to gapminder.org where you can pull down all kinds of PowerPoints to show your supervisors why integrating inequality measures in your work with children is so essential. And you can teach the kids themselves. You see, because one of the things that happens to our kids back home is these First Nations kids who are getting 30% less for education, going to schools that are sitting on toxic waste dumps, they actually start to internalize that discrimination as their own inability. We're too stupid, and that's why I can't learn. My family's too messed up, and that's why I can't grow up at home. When the real problem is that if you put any Canadian in that situation, they would be experiencing the same issue. The problem is not the family, it's not the child, it's the discrimination. Now, let's take a look at how we're doing here in our two countries. This is from the IMF and the World Bank, and you can see there that in terms of world economies, we're right up there once again with each other. We're slightly ahead at number 11 in the world, and Australia's number 12. And we're just heading up into a federal election, thank heaven, in Canada. And we're starting to hear the political parties all sell this one spin. And what they say to you is, vote for me because I'll be looking out for you. I'm about jobs, I'm about the economy, and if you vote for me, you're gonna be able to feed your family, right? I think that's the narrative of every politician around the world. The problem is, it's not true. When you look at the rate of investment of various nation states in children, remember where you were in the economic rating? Look at where your kids are. Your economy is doing twice as well as your children. And this isn't Aboriginal children, this is all children in Australia. So look at the track you're laying for your economic future in your country. And we're not doing any very much better. But what if you ask another question? Because at election time, when NGOs and Aboriginal groups go to government and say, we really need some additional funds to address certain issues, they say, we're doing the best we can, it's hard economic times. Who's heard that? That? I think the Canadian government and Australian government maybe meet quite regularly, don't you think? Well, there's a wonderful organization called the Kids' Rights Foundation. I was so honored to work with Yap Doak a number of years ago on a UN general comment on Indigenous issues. And that organization that he now works with decided to ask a very interesting question. How well are children in these different countries doing proportionate to the wealth of the country, right? So I think you guys were at number 12 in the GDP rankings, is that right? So we should see Australia right there at number 12, right? If they actually are investing, doing everything that they can. And Canada was number 11, right? Let's take a look and see how you rank. We rank 60th in the world in terms of respecting children's rights, in terms of investing in children proportionate to our wealth. And you are 26th in the world. Your economy is doing about 2.4 times better than your kids are. We all know that the best investment any government can make is in your children. So look at the future that your government is painting out for your nation, right? Ours is even worse. I mean, it was considered one of the most shocking findings of the Kids' Rights Index, and this is just last year's data, so this is pretty fresh off the batch. And I would suspect if you took Aboriginal children and you looked at Australia's record on that, it would be far worse than that. In fact, in Canada, in the year we ranked number one in the world on a human development index, by the government's own calculations, First Nations ranked 69th in the world, down with Central American countries. So let's look at this question of overrepresentation, because we've come up with this discourse internationally to nicely codify these structural risks. And we see that in the overrepresentation of First Nations children in child welfare in Canada. Depending on the province, you're 3 to 19 times more likely to end up in foster care if you're First Nations. And why are you there? Remember the kid said? It's poverty, poor housing, and substance misuse. Now, I've had the pleasure and honor of working with SNCC and other Aboriginal groups working in child welfare, and they let me know, and I've seen in your government data as well, those are the same reasons that disproportionately drive Aboriginal children here into child welfare care. How many people here do child protection? Who here has had more than a half day of training on poverty, its impacts on parenting, and what you can do about it as a child welfare worker? Who here has had more than a half day of training on housing, its impacts on parenting, and what you can do about it as a child welfare worker? Isn't it unsurprising that the system isn't helping families when we're not even providing the good people out there on the front line the basic knowledge in order to address the problems? What do we do around the world in child protection? When we find a family that's neglectful, and I think that's a very damaging and dangerous word that we need to unpack, by the way. Because neglect, in my view, means I have the tools and resources to parent and I choose not to do it. And many of our families don't have the tools and resources to parent. So what we're doing is we will refer them to parenting skills. Now, I think everybody needs parenting skills. I certainly did. But how good is parenting skills if the issues are poverty, poor housing, and substance misuse, right? It doesn't make any sense whatsoever. And people forget two important facts about being poor. One is it's exhausting. Everything takes so much longer. What I'd like to do with every social work student in Canada is send them out with 5 bags of laundry, 3 toddlers, and half of the money to be able to do the laundry at the laundromat. And I think that would be the very best social worker training we could provide. And if you want to see people who really know how to stretch a dollar, talk to a single parent on income assistance, right? And poverty costs more. When you cannot afford a car, you got to buy your milk from the corner store where they rack the prices up by 3 times as much. Or you got to go to payday loans to get your funds for your family, to feed your family. And then what do? As a child welfare worker who's already has their laundry machine and everything else, we say, look, what you need to do on top of trying to do the laundry and do all these other things is going to parenting classes. You know, like, we really need to stop doing this stupidity, right? It's no reason. This is not rocket science, I don't think, right? So I'm going to go back and just show you one of the things of data. You can think about the overrepresentation in a couple of ways. You can do it as the Australian government, my government, collects it, which is the number of Aboriginal children in care in any given day. Or you can think about it the way that children think about it. How many sleeps until I go home? When we added up the number of nights the First Nations children in Canada on reserve only, so this is not off reserve, spent in child welfare care between 1989 and 2012, it was 66 million nights. 187,000 years of childhood. Our country is only 150 years old. We have to stop looking at just the individual and start seeing these patterns, just like the kids see the patterns, right? Now, the kids told you about this human rights case. What do you do about these inequalities? And of course you sit down with government and you try to document the problem, which I know you have done a good job of here because I read many of the reports. I see government even agreeing with many of the recommendations you make, and then I see them nicely shelving those on the side. They will move on a couple of the recommendations that cost no money and are very easy to do. And normally we make that easy for them because we make about 100 recommendations. So they can cherry pick amongst them instead of making one recommendation, which is reduce the inequalities, right? So I'm just watching my watch because I don't want to go over time. But I would be sitting at these negotiating tables, folks. I'm an academic by training. I go sitting at these negotiating tables. And I was so frustrated. And so I ended up in India. And there's two types of museum goers, as I think it, you know? There's a museum goer who, you know, and you know them. Some of you are them. You're the people who walk into the museum or art gallery and you head for the headphones. You know the headphones? And you listen to every single tape and read every single plaque. And then if you're at the art gallery, you stand back and take it all in for half an hour. Right? Those are folks who spend 4 or 5 days in the museums. And then you have the type A personality like me, who looks at the map, identifies 4 or 5 highlights, and then spends most of their time in the restaurant and the gift shop. So I was at one of my heroes' home, Mahatma Gandhi, right? It's now been converted into a museum. And I went through there, and I was with a friend who was the headphones kind of person. So I was through much quicker. And I found myself outside waiting for him. And I'm there in the company of the maintenance worker. And he's smoking a cigarette. And he asked me what I do for a living, right? And that just gave me an opening right there, because I was so frustrated with the government. I said, we sit there, we meet with these people, they're nice, they smile back, they agree with us, I'm sure they're good people, they really do want to do something. And then they say, just don't raise it another level. Don't go to the press because we got a new minister coming in next week and they'll do the right thing. And then nothing happens. And then we get a new bureaucrat coming to the table and the same thing goes on. And anyway, as you can tell, I'm a bit of a talker. So the poor guy didn't get a word in edgewise until finally his cigarette is done and I had to breathe. And he said, how long have you been at this? And I said, well, about 20 years. And he said, every time you have this conversation, you have it with the government. And every time you have the conversation, you get the same result. And yet every time you go back to have the conversation with them. Didn't you learn anything in that house? He said, the conversation you need to have is with the Canadian people. Governments don't create change, they respond to change. And at some point, that becomes a question and the challenge for all of you. And if you're going to take on your government or some of the more powerful institutions in your country, you better have your courage ready. In 2007, with the Caring Society, we were so honored to be created by the First Nations communities to tackle this issue. And when we were created, an elder told us something very, very important. He said, Cindy, never fall in love with the Caring Society. Never fall in love with it. And never fall in love with those initials on your business card. Only fall in love with the children. Because you're going to have to sacrifice those two things for them one day. And so as we sat around the table and we thought, what else are we going to do? Do we go back and talk to the government of Canada after creating two evidence-based solutions that would have cost them 0.5% of their surplus budget to implement and they walked away and didn't do it? Do you think going back and talking to them would have worked? What do you think would happen if we took the Canadian government to court? Do you think that we would lose all of our money? We thought so. But again, one of the elders spoke up and he said, look, I'd rather you die on your feet than live on your knees. And at some point, as children's organizations, we have to woman up and man up and take the hit. And so we filed a human rights complaint against the Canadian government. We allege that the Canadian government is racially discriminating against First Nations children. We filed it under an act that could provide a legal finding of discrimination and order the Canadian government to fix it. Our organization had 4 people at the time. 40% of our budget came from the federal government. We lost all of our federal government funding within 30 days. And it was interesting with the philanthropist on the table, on the panel yesterday, because one of the things I wondered about is that in our own country, although we have great philanthropists and some of them are courageous, in general, the philanthropic community does not fund courage. They really don't feel that they want to fund someone who's taken on the Canadian government. They'll fund a parenting program. And that's something all of us need to reflect about, because I really think it's those people who are willing to get into the most trouble for doing the right thing that we all need to get beyond and support. It's the troublemakers amongst us who really hold the most potential to ending this passing on of trauma and the more passing on of hope. So we filed this thing and then we only had $50,000 in the bank. Where do we get the $50,000? From my keynotes, which I invest back in the thing. And I wondered, how are we going to do this? And this is another important thing. If you're going to take on something as big as the government, you're never going to be ready. You just got to do it anyway. There's a beautiful poem, a book of poems my aunt once gave me, and it's about faith. It talks about what the elder once told me about spirit, right? Faith is knowing that when you step across that place where light leads into darkness, that there's something solid for you to stand on, or you'll be taught to fly. And I knew there were 200 lawyers in the Department of Justice down the street. I knew that if I had staff, I had to pay. But I knew that we would be taught to fly. And that came in an envelope with pencil crayon just a few days later. Now, I'm suspicious of mail that I generally get because I'm under surveillance by the Canadian government, which is another reason that I'm fairly well known. But and now, since I'm here with all of you, they will know you as well. That's a good thing. So welcome to that world. But it was a letter, and I opened it up, and it said, "Dear Cindy, here's some M-U-N-Y for the kids. Love, Ella." And inside was $1.67 from her piggy bank, and she was 5 years old. And at that moment, I knew that we were going to be okay. When we filed that case in 2007, for those of you, anybody ever been to Ottawa, to our parliament? No? You come out and there's this walkway. And we had filed what I felt was the most important human rights case of our time. It struck at the very conscience of Canadian values of fairness and of freedom. And yet there was nobody there. I can still remember the sound of my heels on that February morning. And in our deepest winter, by the way, you do not have winter. So don't even call it that. You know, it's kind of like a long spring you get here. But in the depths of winter, when our cold, things echo a lot more. Some of you who have been in that deep cold know that. Your sounds echo a lot more. And I could hear those echoes of my heels hitting the pavement as tourists took pictures of the Parliament Hill. All that started to change when we created a program called I Am a Witness, where we don't ask caring Canadians to take a side, we simply ask them to watch. We loaded up all of the Canadian government's court documents and all of ours, and we simply asked people to watch. Now, what would they see? They'd see the Canadian government trying to get off on and derail it on legal technicalities for over 6 years. They spent $3.5 million doing it. And these are the technicalities they said. They said, "We, the federal government, do actually not pay or deliver the child welfare services. We fund this Indigenous community here to do it. And if they're providing a lower level of service, then they're the ones discriminating, not us." Alternatively, they would say, "Well, the provinces provide funding for the non-Aboriginal people, but it's not fair to compare us with the provinces." Those are the arguments that they were holding. And I wondered who would come and watch this thing. And for a while, things were quite slow until a group of teenagers arrived at the hearings one day. And this young man came up to me and he said, "We're from alternative school, which means we get into trouble a lot." I said, "That's good, because so do I." And he said, sometimes we deserve it, but a lot of times it's those systems that deserve to be in trouble. And you know what? Adults really don't like taking the systems on, but you are. And not only that, you want our help, so we're here. And they sat there in the thing of being a witness. And I really believe if you engage children, you must do it in a very respectful way that promotes critical thought. So I always tell the kids, you come and listen to the government side of the story too. It's like being a newspaper reporter. You listen to both sides of the story, you go on the internet, and then you make up your own mind about what's going on. And this is Shanara. She said, "I wanted to say that when I started the process of being a witness, I only learned about one side of the story, the First Nations side. But after witnessing both days of the tribunal hearings, I realized there is no other side of the story." And what did she do? Well, she went back and she designed all these t-shirts. You see these young people wearing all these t-shirts? And those are I Am a Witness t-shirts. And they brought with them a lot of their friends and their younger brothers and sisters to the next set of hearings. Now, imagine yourself if you're Canada, the government lawyers, who would you rather look out at? People like your age or theirs? The next set of hearings in 2012, so many children wanted to come to the hearings that we had to move it to the Supreme Court of Canada and building and move them in shifts. Now, if you are the government and you're arguing against this case and you're looking back at 10-year-olds, your only hope is that they don't understand the legal gobbledygook, right? So I came out, and there's this little boy there, and he's got a scrap piece of paper. Do you know the tallies? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5? Big long list on one side, short list on the other. And he said, that was the day Canada was presenting its case, because I had told him he needs to go listen to the Canada side. And he says, you know what this is? And I said, no. He said, the long list is when the judge asks the Canada people a question, and the short list is when the Canada people answered. You know, children, they look up at us, and they really are making judgments every day about whether or not we're really doing what matters. A little 6-year-old girl who came to those hearings, she said, I thought this case was about what's good for kids, so why is the government talking about everything except for what we really need? They're using all kinds of big words, and none of them are really what we need. Now, you might be looking forward to your coffee break if you were the government of Canada. You'd be wanting to go outside maybe and get a bit of fresh air. And where did I put that stuff? I wander so much. Over there? Oh, over in that table. So the kids were outside. Do you have Valentine's Day in Australia?
Yes.
Okay. Well, kids are always sending Valentines to their nanas and their friends. And we thought, who needs a Valentine more than our Prime Minister? And so the kids are going to be up writing Valentines to the Prime Minister. So First Nations children can grow up safely in their families, get a good education, be healthy, and proud of who they are. And not only that, the kids decided, why just put them in the mail when we can come up to Parliament Hill ourselves? And we could read them to the Prime Minister. And maybe he'll come outside and listen. So this is Imran. You might think, what could kids possibly understand about this stuff? So, dear Prime Minister Harper, my name is Imran. I think that just because your skin color is different or you have a different religion does not mean that you should be treated differently. Like right now, we have proper houses and water and schools. In Attawapiskat, they don't have that. But they're human beings too. I think something should be done. And P.S., we're really trying hard to correct the mistakes we made from the past, and you are not helping. P.P.S., write back with an explanation. And then we have Bethany, and she stands up and she says, Dear Prime Minister Harper, I think you should go back to grade 5 because that's where you learn about something called the Charter of Rights and Freedoms that says that everyone is supposed to be treated fairly. And then we had Elliot, who you saw in the film, actually. And Elliot said, Dear Prime Minister Harper, I hear you're over in China, and I hope you're having a good trip. But you know, I heard you criticizing their human rights, but you got a lot of problems back home. So maybe you want to get on the next plane and come and listen to us about what some of our solutions are. You know, we talk about consulting with kids, and we talk about doing things for them. But I really believe in raising a generation of First Nations and non-Aboriginal children who are active participants in creating the world that they want to grow up in, who learn about critical thinking and are willing to take on some of the toughest issues of our time, waiting until their young people's too late. If we want that fresh start that you were talking about, Michael, it doesn't come out of the mouths of people like you and I. It comes out of the hearts and the minds and the spirits of the children themselves. It comes out of the creations that they make. And it comes, and our job here is to make space for that. To not stand as an intermediary when they're writing to the Prime Minister, to actually have them write themselves. To take the young people with you when you go to the United Nations and have them speak to the United Nations, not you. We have to say, be honest about the systems that we're breaking. And we must not model complacency. And we have to stop focusing and codifying systemic discrimination as a personal or cultural risk. And one other thing about your winters. You see, we in Canada, when it comes to protesting, we have heart. And warm boots, which are necessary when you're under minus 30 degrees. So the kids understand that you write these letters to the Prime Minister, but you need to keep going, because what they told me is adults don't listen. And they don't keep their, and sometimes they make promises, but they need help keeping them. So the kids have said, we are going to continue to write, and we're going to continue to come to Parliament Hill every year. This was just this last February. Every year until things change for the children. And if we're still raising our own families, we're going to bring our children here. And isn't that the real hope of reconciliation? This is the author of the book, some of the authors of the books. And I think here in Australia, this is something you could be doing too, whether you're a line worker or you're working at an organization. And some people say, well, it's not right to involve people, children in politics. Anyone kind of feeling a little bit crunchy about that? I think that's naive. Our work is political. What's really important is to teach the kids not to be partisan. And as Bethany gave in a speech to the members of Parliament, she said, the one thing that I know as a child, I'm on a hockey, girls' hockey team, the one thing that my coach says is I'm supposed to be playing for the team on the front of the sweater, not the name on the back. And you as adults are supposed to be working for everybody in the country, not just the party that you stand up for. Isn't that where we should be teaching all of our kids? So political engagement really invokes that. One of the other things we've done at the tribunal is made it very transparent. You can actually go on to APTN News and you can watch all the witnesses testify, including the government witnesses. The closing arguments are on October 20th to 24th. We expect the ruling to come 4 to 6 months later. It is the only example in the world where a developed country has been on trial for its contemporary treatment of Indigenous children. And it was recognized last year by the Nobel Women's Initiative as one of the 16 most important human rights actions of our time. But I think the Nobel Committee really needs to have a kids' award, because really it's the children that are leading this movement. And here's a great resource for bringing it into the teachers. People say, well, how do you get it into the schools? This is a fantastic organization that does that, and we're really proud to work with them. And we're creating a new journal. I'm going to end with one story, and then I'm going to show you some of the kids, and I promise I'll let you get to tea. I grew up in the bush. Some of you heard me say that in dinner time. And I was taught there that the most important and wise people in the world would say things to me as a four-year-old that I would continue to begin to understand the rest of my life, but would always remain to be true. And then I went to grade one in Western academia, and I thought I was stupid. I could not make it in grade one. And then I finally realized why. Because unlike at home, where you were wise if you said something that was essentially true about the world and would discover that throughout your lifetime, the real meaning of that. In Western education, you are smart to the degree that you are not understood by anybody else. So I got out the dictionary. I got the longest word possible, and I fired that out, and I went from the bottom of the class to the top of the class in one heap. And I went right on through the whole system up to the PhD, where you produce a dissertation only three people in the world are going to read, and that's only because they have to. Right? And we create these journals in Western academia that get more dull as you go along the continuum, because it weeds out everybody who's got any kind of sensibility and wants to look at pictures. So we have something called the Child and Family Review, but instead of having more academic articles roll in, we decided we would do something different this year. And you can look forward to the children's edition. They're going to be peer reviewing their own poems and songs and letters. And I think this is going to be the best edition that we have going out further. So I want you to no longer think of this as a complex problem. I want you to understand one thing essentially, and that is caring is not enough. It's what you do that matters. What are you going to do about the historic injustices being done to Aboriginal people in this country right now? The next time you see overrepresentation in trauma, overrepresentation in child welfare, overrepresentation in a prison, that's your calling card to get on the internet and send the government a letter. And never forget that that's your responsibility in this work. It takes four things to change the world. Knowledge, and a lot of people have that. Persistence, and some people have that. Passion, and a lot of people will criticize you for that. And spirit, and you need to remember that. The kids and I would like to gift to all of you one of our candles of hope for Indigenous children. We're going to leave it in the trusteeship of Judy Atkinson. And in 2 years' time, I hope that you'll be able to show all kinds of letters from your kids on Valentine's Day being sent to your Prime Minister to make this in Australia truly worthy of your children's dreams. Thank you so much.